are almost 2.5 million kids. When I looked at the university, I was terribly upset and disturbed. The universities in Hyderabad are not being built by the forces today which are supporting the university. A lot of effort has gone in by the students of Hyderabad University and the faculty. Even the non-teaching contributed enormously for building university. And we entered into a very sad period that last 2 years, the party which has come into power, instead of building institutions, although they talk of nationalism, patriotism, nationalism, patriotism go with building up of institutions of which you can be proud. But you are dismantling the institutions. And we have seen Jawaharlal Nehru University, Hyderabad University, Jadavpur University, then Pune University, Pune Film Institute, then Allahabad University, then Aligarh, then Delhi IIT. Now you look at these universities, and one way or the other associated with all these universities which still have some respect. Jadavpur University still has some life in respect to all. Pune University still has some respect. Baroda University of Gujarat is still a university which is alive. They have targeted both universities which have still survived. Several other universities already collapsed, state universities. But they are targeting the universities. Hyderabad University also is not, an exception. It's a part of the larger strategy of the fascist forces to dismantle, because every institution which is creative, capable of training the students in question, capable of training very, students, for this larger society, I think these are the universities which are targeted. And I think we have to understand what is happening in the larger context also. It's not necessarily with the Hyderabad. It's another trend that they are appointing vice-chancellors. Normally, governments appoint vice-chancellors to solve the problem, to build the institution. But I think it was very symbolic, or it was very, epitomized when Subramanian Swami's name floated as a vice-chancellor of Jawaharlal Nehru University. Well, the channels asked him, what will you do if you become vice-chancellor of Jawaharlal Nehru University? He said, I'll close down the university. What he said, I'll close down the university and I'll start Sardar Patel University. Or some Subhash Chandra Bose University. Now, see, it's very surprising, when somebody name is voted, if somebody goes ask and they say, I'll build a first-rate university, internationally reputed university, first time I'm hearing a person whose name voted saying that I'll close down the university. Subramanian Swami is an erratic chap, but he also sometimes speaks, which is symbolic of the times or the spirit of the times. He's an aberration, but he's an aberration which has to be seen very seriously. So when he said that I'll go down to Jawaharlal Nehru University, you can understand what is the type of candidate they are looking. So vice chancellors are joining, they have seen what JNU vice chancellor has done. And JNU vice chancellor asked all the faculty members to give the answer. Answers along with the question paper. And the fear in the JNU was that they would like to leak out to certain sections of the society and see that they come to JNU and change the entire political character of the universities. So Hyderabad University, our science departments, our scholars, they have been. But one major problem with the University of Hyderabad right from the beginning has been, some of us have been seeing it, that scholars or the scientists or the faculty who are very competent in a very mainstream sense, but sensitivity, social commitment, concern for the students, they are missing largely. There are some faculty members, that's an exception, but largely the difference between JNU and Hyderabad University is the large faculty members do not have that type of social concern. And you can see the difference in JNU. When the action was to be taken, the entire faculty went. When the police was to be invited inside the campus, the whole 300 faculty members went and protested. The academic council, they protested, and the vice chancellor ran away from the academic council. now, whereas in the University of Hyderabad, I find, I'm talking about my colleagues, but I feel very sad that first they should protect the university, then you know what happens at 50, but you are coming to the university is on a suicidal path. And you know, as a part of that, see, you have to understand that, and the discrimination which the Dalit students, particularly the rural students, particularly girls, it has not yet come out, but the girl students, the discrimination that they experience in University of Hyderabad. I was a faculty, you know, I was a dean, you know, students used to come, women scholars used to come. And this is the trend in the University of Hyderabad. And 11 girls who were suddenly, you know, emerged as a very militant group, very articulate group. The vice chancellor used to tell me that if we remove these 11 girls, Hyderabad will be peaceful. I was always telling, first 10 girls are asserting, what are, why are you doing this? I mean, in other words, any dissent, they always think it is counterproductive to anti-academic. I think I am again appealing to the faculty of the University of Hyderabad, the entire faculty, that please understand that the dissent, questioning, you know, on the part of the students, is a part of the growth of the university. No university will ever grow if you do not allow the student to question. There are differences among the students, that's a different thing, there are ideological differences, there are. But otherwise, but at least the university should be committed to the students who come as a first generation from the rural area, from the mother tongue educated, in a particular girl students need a lot of confidence and a certain, you know, confidence in this institution. That, you know, I think this has been missing. But then, University of Hyderabad took Dalit students, that they started Ambedkar Student Association. It was an offshoot of this. I saw the birth of the Ambedkar Student Association. If the students used to come, feel discriminated. They can't find library, they can't find where the examination branch, they do not know where the office is, they do not know the medium, so there are problems. And the Dalit students, when they formed, they started certain confidence in the umbrella organization. Students used to go and consult them. They used to come and represent, sometimes fight for the causes. And I think one must understand that this organization has come up as a part of our failure, as an institution. And the students had to take up the issues and all that. But the general feeling among the faculty is that they are all creating problems, but you are forgetting there is a discrimination on the campus. Discrimination in different forms. And I think that had to be fought. But then the politics of the country started changing very fast. And the semi-fascist forces, they started rising. For different reasons, I am not going to that political economy of why today India is opting for this, you know, religious, you know, communalism, this fundamentalism, and the whole imperialism and the fundamentalism. Those who are talking of nationalism, they are not opposed to foreign direct investment. Direct investment in defense production. What type of nationalism are you talking about? When you allow the foreign direct right into defense production, you are exporting raw material of the country. What type of nationalism is that? I think it's a very serious question in the political economy. But I mean, not understanding those things, that to invite the foreign universities into India, they are preparing the ground, and they started with the Congress Party, the BJP is taking it forward. And right in the, you know, I attended All India Vice Chancellor Conference, and in the All India Vice Chancellor Conference, of course I was not a Vice Chancellor, but I was invited to head the panel on justice and social discrimination on the campuses. And you know, I was, you know, we were 17 Vice Chancellors were in this panel. We debated 2 days, but Kapil Sibal comes, and then he says that when will foreign universities come to India? Foreign university bill is not passing in the parliament. When will this country go ahead? When will this country progress? How will this country progress if foreign universities don't come? And as a part of that, Delhi University 4-year degree course, he has introduced because America has 4-year degree course. And you know, whole Delhi University, I was in a Delhi University, you know, in 1980s as a visiting faculty. But the Delhi University passed into a major crisis. And we know that some of the degree colleges of Delhi University, undergraduate colleges, that they are some of the best colleges of the world, not of India, but the best colleges of the world. And they wanted to dismantle Delhi University. And Kapil Sibal played that role, but anyway, that politics are different. And they, when the BJP took over from the Congress, they started dismantling the institution fast. And Hyderabad University suddenly got into this whole crisis. And then the Dalit boys, you know, the Mehman's case, you know, Abdul Guru's case, all this is all, you know, these things have been going on. You know, students do protest. Students do have a dissent. Students have their own opinions. that can be debated, that can be negotiated. But just because students say something, I mean, from Socrates downwards, this is all the problem. The dissent, you know, becomes intolerable. The Socrates was given poison. But today you hold Socrates, you know, as one of the most, you know, I mean, illuminating, you know, minds of the world. I mean, the scientists had to suffer at the hands of religious orthodoxy. I mean, look at the entire, you know, I mean, Galileo, Copernicus, Bruno was burnt alive. What happened to philosopher? What happened to scientists? Religious orthodoxy in the medieval period, you know, in the 16th, 17th, modern science was growing. Science professors should know that they had to fight. Galileo and Copernicus had to fight with the religious orthodoxy, with the establishment. So no knowledge will ever grow without dissent. That's one thing. And therefore, students will ask questions. But you should not think it is indisciplined, all that. Student can argue. Student can debate. But that's what is the function of the university. But at the same time, you must know that in a society like India, the boys and girls who come from rural background, mother tongue, vulnerable background, caste discrimination, how does university deal with it? It must deal in a most democratic manner. A great problem, you know, the thousands of years of anger is there, cumulative anger. One should understand. University should contribute to social transformation. It is not merely production of knowledge and transmission of knowledge. It must contribute to social change. That's the function of university. And I think forgetting this, you know, role of the university in the emancipatory politics, in the transformative politics, I think Hyderabad University got lost. It lost its direction. And that is the state where the entire suspension of the Dalit boys, then the whole, you know, somebody calling them gundas and, you know, hooligans, and they protesting, and their protest was taken more seriously than original comment on the, you know, internet that they were called hooligans. Why does anybody call somebody hooligan? If somebody calls me hooligan, don't have a right to go and protest that, you know, why you have called me hooligan? That comment hooligan is forgotten. But the protests of the Dalit boys have been taken very seriously. And based on that, they contacted the school and got these five boys suspected. Earlier also 11 boys were suspected. This has been a sort of been going on, but this time it led to the... But this time I was telling to media that last time some suicides have taken place from how to make it happen. And you know, the suicides were of different reasons, you know, the wrong allotment or not non-allotment of the supervising law. This time, Rohit Vemula wrote a letter. This is what I am saying, he wrote a letter to the Vice Chancellor, saying that when we enter the University of Hyderabad, we will be discriminated. So please give us a poison or a rope. What else in your concept? It's a very powerful letter, I would say. Any Vice Chancellor having a sense would have immediately called the emergency meeting of the Executive Council. Would have called the meeting of the faculty and placed the letter and called Rohit Vemula, debated, discussed with him, asked some faculty to talk to him. Nothing. We just waited till, you know, he committed suicide. So I think, you know, this entire thing was pushed to wall, and he has taken away his life. He has such a brilliant mind, you can see his writing. His suicide note is now a historic statement on the nature of the society, the nature of the university, the nature of society in which we are living. Now, after that, at least, you know, the Rohilas, you know, Rohit Vemula's thing, the university should have initiated a debate, a big dialogue. And the whole faculty should have been engaged. And how to restore the university, normalcy in the university. Instead, now they go ahead with a foolish, you know, path. And then Professor Appa Rao arrives, and Appa Rao comes. And you know, as a faculty, as has been a part of the university system, he has a responsibility, has a burden. He knows what is the University of Hyderabad. And he should have initiated immediately a dialogue. Instead, now the problem gets aggravated. And the Rohit Vemula takes his life. And then, you know, after that, you do nothing. And then the problem, then you call the police. We were completely, when we were faculty members, we were completely, you know, I mean, opposed to the entry of the police. And then, if you hand over the problem to police, university has lost its moral authority over the students. If I can't handle my students, how can a policeman handle? As the faculty, you know, once it is involved in the open dialogue with the student, no student can say that will not talk to our faculty. University could have solved this problem. I mean, when, you know, the university, the JNU students went on a fast, Mr. Alag, Professor Alec Ben, he was the vice chancellor. He also went on a hunger strike against the school. He put a tent. He said, all right, you are going, I also have a protest against you. But there were two tents, one vice chancellor, one student. And that's one way of opening a dialogue. Vice chancellor himself protesting. But he has not called police. There are vice chancellors. Upendra Bakshi was the vice chancellor. Mandal Commission agitation went on. And when the Mandal Commission, the ministry, MHRD rang up to Upendra Bakshi saying, close down Delhi University. He said, it's not your job. It's not for MHRD to tell me what I should do with my university. These are the type of vice chancellors we had in this country. Now these vice chancellors are playing as if, you know, the MHRD, you know, is the main tune setter and the vice chancellors are dancing. I don't know what they are doing. What type of academic motive we are. But who is Smriti Irani? Who is the MHRD? They are created by an act of parliament. MHRD has nothing to do with the universities. Please understand that. They are not supposed to interfere in the affairs of the university. They are accountable to the people of India through parliament. That's all. They are not accountable to MHRD. That's the reason why we are created by an act of parliament. Forgetting all that, now he has come. I thought that he may still negotiate. I thought still he may open a dialogue. But instead of opening a dialogue, now he suspended the two faculty members. And when the two faculty members are arrested, see, his job is to immediately ring up the police. How can you take my faculty? Please, no, see, what is this happening? And the vice chancellor should object. Say that you can't take away my faculty. I will, you know, talk to them. So you, I mean, the police pick up and you don't protest. Your students are picked up. I mean, see, this is something where you are handing over the whole problem to the state, to the police. I mean, I was talking to the commissioner continuously. I was talking to him. He said, what to do? See, your university is going on pushing us. You don't want. But what to do? The university asked, you know, their law and order missionary, we have not left with many options. So we have to send some force. But then you call the police and the students are arrested. You don't care what happened to them, whether they got bail. The vice chancellor, as the head of the institution, should be worried. Instead, you know, see, the problem is complicated, they get bail, they come back. Then after they come back, two faculty members who are good teachers, good human beings, have access, students have access to them, they're great assets. This Tathagat and, you know, Ratnam, they're great assets of the Hyderabad University. They have access to the students have access to them. No university can ever act against a teacher who is popular, who is accessible, who is moral and who is good teacher. No university will do that. But again, you know, you call your executive council meeting. I don't know what type of great executive council is this. But they take, you know, suggest that these teachers should be suspended. For what? For suppressing information. What information? That they were arrested and they were in the, you know, I mean, they were in the custody and therefore they are suspended. Is it not ridiculous that the executive council of University of Hyderabad said that these people suppressed the fact? They were picked up the evening, it was in the media. Next day, you know, they Times of India interviewed me. I talked about Ratnam with their photographs, you know, the new Times of India carried. What type of teacher they are, what type of background they have. Now you say that we don't know that you are arrested, you are under custody. And all right, you know, they could have, you know, say they called, you know, see, asked what happened, you know, they could have asked a heads of department to talk to them, but instead, the highest body of the university meets and suspends them. I think, friends, this is the limit. What University of Hyderabad is the limit. This can happen to any faculty member. I am telling, cautioning the Hyderabad University faculty. Today you may have one vice chancellor, tomorrow there may be another vice chancellor. And the minute you differ with the vice chancellor, if this is the way that university acts, every teacher is vulnerable. Please understand that. First you have to protect your rights. Every teacher has to protest if they have to be protected. But if they don't, and if they think that this happened to Tathagat and Ratnam, it can happen to anybody. This is how, you know, the crisis develops. Outside forces are anyway, some sort of fascist forces are developing. But universities have to protect themselves. And that's the reason why I take this occasion, because when they are sitting on this fast, it is not for their own case and suspension. It's fighting for values. If I am suspended, if I am protesting, I come and sit. And then telling the rest of the society that, look, this is what is happening in this university. He's not fighting for my cause. If I have to fight, no, I can fight the cause, you know, in different ways. I can go to vice chancellor and request him, sir, please withdraw. No, say sorry and all that. But people who stand for values, people who stand for beliefs, people who can see the system in a larger context alone stand to stake it. That's why their protest is totally justified. I hope some sense will prevail on University of Hyderabad and the Executive Council will withdraw this suspension, apologize to the two teachers and give confidence to the rest of the teachers that dissent is a part of the university. You can dissent. You can argue with the Vaishnavs. You can go and question the Vaishnavs. In fact, I called a Vaishnavs to shut up. Because you know, the Vaishnavs said something which was not, you know, I mean, tolerable to me. Once he said, no, I thought that, okay, I mean, see this, but second time when he repeated, in a meeting I said that you shut up. What nonsense you are talking? That's the dignity of teacher. What is, you know, see the Vaishnavs can do anything, they can talk anything and get away. We are not slaves. We are not bonded labor of the Vaishnavs. We belong, and Vaishnavs is only the, you know, coordinate. His job is just to coordinate the activities of people, not the hierarchy, not the boss over. There's nothing like hierarchy in university. Youngest teacher can question the oldest teacher. That's what university is all about. I think this is too much, you know, it's very sad that it happened to the University of Hyderabad. And I again demand from the university that it should be withdrawn. And I endorse and I fully support the protest that Tathagat and Ratnam started, because this is protecting Ratnam and Tathagat. You are not protecting only your interests. You are also setting a path for protecting the dignity of the teachers of the University of Hyderabad. That's how I see this protest. I think it is in that larger context. I fully support and I hope that some sense will prevail on the University of Hyderabad. And the larger society should stand by these causes. Larger society should not ignore, should not be indifferent. Larger society should get more engaged. Then they must understand what's happening. And there should be a widespread public opinion, strong public opinion against such trends. I think that's one of the jobs that all of us have to do in our own way, in whatever way we can do it, we have to do it. And therefore, I compliment both the faculty members. They are my colleagues, because you know, Lakshmarayan is known to me, and both of us are working in a movement. Tathagat, known for his values, frankness, outspokenness, and his brilliance, and everybody knows that. And two good teachers being suspended is something that I can never imagine. But I think that's the reason why I appeal to the student community to stand by their teachers, stand by certain causes, and protect the university of Hyderabad, and so that protect the universities in the country, good university. I thank them, to thank all of you for giving me this opportunity to share this agony and anguish. And I feel very agonized. I am not a part of the university, but I feel agonized. Very anguished, because these things are happening in university, which, you know, I serve for 2.5 years. So fond of this university, but today I feel completely upset. But let us fight. Let us fight. Thank you.